Wow, it's yet another glorious sunny day here in Yorkshire. And I've taken a trip out today to Myenergi to find out about a new government regulation that's gone through Parliament that's going to affect everybody who drives and charges an electric vehicle. Now, when it comes to regulatory changes, we turn to trusted people we've had on the channel before. We're here to see Dr. Chris Horne of Myenergi to find out what these changes mean. So let's go and see what he's got to say. So Chris, it's great to have the opportunity to catch up in the new, incredibly impressive Myenergi facility. It seems like Myenergi's come a long way in actually quite a short space of time.
Well, welcome. It's great that you could come and visit us here. You're right. I mean, it's just over 2 years since we probably first spoke and met in a Porter cabin at Bimbrook. We had, 20, 30 staff then, and we're now at 350 and still growing. So it's been a fantastic journey in that time.
Yeah, and look what's happened in the world now. Electric cars are everywhere. They're always in the news. Energy is always in the news at the minute. Obviously, energy prices are going up. That's causing a lot of people concern. But we're here not to talk about the great Myenergi products. The government is now taking a really significant interest in what's going on inside electric vehicle charge points. And we've got a new act. And I don't think ever in 30 years in the electrical industry, I've seen an act that specifically targets a very specific bit of kit that you put on the wall in a house.
Well, I think these regulations are trying to address three points. The first one is putting the consumer at the center of what we do with charging. So do consumers have the right information about how much it's costing them to charge their cars, how much energy they're using to charge their cars? And you know, if you're in a supply contract, you don't want to be locked into that supply contract because of the charge points. So there's a couple of regulations there around accuracy of metering, information provided, and the ability to move between energy suppliers.
Okay, so that's like a customer really wants to know. At the moment, most people have a reasonable idea of the miles per gallon for a car. It's just transferring that into an electric world, so you know exactly how much does it cost to run a car.
That's right, yes. Okay, so the second point is around security of supply, and there are various concerns being raised that if everybody has an electric vehicle and we all plug in at the same time, then the grid won't be able to cope. So part of these regulations are about trying to spread that load out through the day to make sure that we don't all start charging at the same time, but also to try to use the electric vehicles to support the grid. So we'd have a different relationship between the energy in our vehicle and just switching it on or just turning the load on and charging the car up.
Okay, and obviously I think we're starting to see that in certain smart tariffs that come out that sort of give you a carrot and stick to charge at certain times.
Yeah.
But reading through those regulations, it looks like it's almost a built-in that there's certain periods will be automatically blanked out, those peak hours that they basically don't want people to be charging.
And that's right. So the load on the grid is at its highest during certain hours of the morning and then sort of late afternoon. So in the morning when you're putting the kettle on, having a shower, that's an industry starting up. And then in the afternoon when everybody's coming home, cooking, turning the kettle on again, whatever the load's going up. Those are the two peak periods. And the new rules say that when you buy a new charger after the end of June, that by default, the charge time should be outside of those two peak periods. So it'll be off peak. And that's good for a number of reasons. And it's not just about the stress on the grid. Actually outside those periods, generation tends to be greener, so less carbon intensive, and potentially cheaper as well if you're on the right tariff.
Okay. Now you can, reading in there, you can opt out of those default periods if you wanted to.
That's right as well. And there's a big change in consumer behaviour here at the moment, because most people, you know, you turn the kettle on, the kettle boils, you turn the lights on, the light comes on, you plug your car in, you expect it to charge straight away. So one of the regulations is don't charge straight away, charge at an off-peak period. Mm-hmm. But if you need the car straight away or you want to charge up straight away, then you can override it and then it will charge.
Okay.
So you have that consumer option, but which the government are trying to encourage people to think about energy in a different way and think about how they can contribute to keeping the lights on.
Yeah, and I guess having to opt out, it sort of makes people think before you push that button. And I guess a certain percentage of people will never even, they'll just install things and leave them forevermore. It stops that, just plugging in without thinking.
And that change of behaviour is going to be quite difficult to introduce. There's a big piece he did about education, which is why I'm happy to be talking, or really pleased to be talking now about that, to share this understanding. You plug your car in and nothing happens. You're going to think that it's broken. And then you've got this message, like, what does this mean? And I'll press a button. And now those first few times, it's going to be disconcerting and then possibly annoying. And then it will just become the behavior that we expect to do. And it's getting to that point.
And then the second thing I picked up in there is this thing called demand response, or always abbreviated DSR.
Yes.
That's going to be quite a new concept for people as well, isn't it?
Absolutely, yes. So at the moment, or historically, if the load on the grid goes up, then we turn on more generation. So you boil the kettle, somewhere there's a generator that's producing a bit more power to supply that kettle. As we get more renewable generation on the grid, which is more dynamic, less easy to maybe turn up or turn down or predict, as we get more controllable loads on the system, we can change the way we think about this. So rather than doing, I turn the load on, I turn the generator up, we can have the world of, well, actually the grid's not got quite enough power at the moment, so let's turn some of the loads down. And this is what the demand side response, demand reduction, is all about.
Okay, so I could be, plug my car in, it started charging, and then, a football match ends.
Yeah, and the kettles all go
the
on.
The kettle's all going, everyone's got the grill on for a bit of, getting a bit hungry. Somebody, the energy company, can then choose to either slow down or stop the car charging, so we don't have to bring in another power station.
Yes, and it might not be the energy company. It could be an aggregator or another party that you've said, I'm happy for you to control my car charging, and they'll just turn it down a bit or delay it. And to be honest, you probably won't know that it's even happened. We've done quite a lot of trials with demand response, and a lot of the customers' feedback is, I had no idea that you'd done anything. My car was charged. I could drive it when I wanted. Isn't that great?
And it swings back to those smart tariffs as well, isn't it? There's a carrot and stick. By allowing somebody to take a little bit of control over your charge point, there's a trade off in terms of energy price as well.
That's expected. Yes.
Yeah. So on the scale of EV cars are going to be installed, that's a massive amount of power swing you can do just by. Sort of tweaking everybody's car charge.
But there's a second level to this as well. So if we don't have demand reduction, what that means is you've got to put more copper in the ground, more cables, more transformers, more generation. So there's lots of capital investment. And that has to be paid by somebody. So it comes through to the bill to the consumer. But if instead of turning more generation up, buying more cables, we could just control the load dynamically, demand response. We don't have to pay for all that infrastructure, so we don't have to pass it on to the consumer, so it keeps the bills lower.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, we all want endless amounts of power, but somebody has to pay for it.
Yeah,
and it's I can almost see Daily Mail headlines in the running on this. Someone takes charge of a charge point. Does that bring in another aspect? Obviously, with all these connected infrastructure out there, they're smart, they're connected to the internet.
Yeah.
What if someone else can interfere in that process?
And that's the third part of the regulations. It's all about cybersecurity and tamper resistance and making sure that can't happen. So, your charge point's connected to the internet. Everybody's used to virus protection on the computers and phishing and all that sort of thing now. When we go down to the Internet of Things, connected devices, we have to be really strong on that security. So encrypted communications, certificates being exchanged to make sure that it's secure. It gets incredibly complicated. Mm-hmm. And that's the third part of the regulations, to say, make sure the data's secure, make sure if the charge point's updated that we know where that update's coming from and that's secure. If someone does try to tamper with it, there's a message to the end user to say, look, something's a bit odd here. Are you sure you're okay? And that's what's being brought in as well.
Okay. So that, that sounds like a lot of work.
Oh, yes.
So I buy my energy charge point from June onwards. What physically will I notice different about the charger from that point?
Physically, nothing.
Right.
Absolutely nothing. It will look exactly the same as one you bought on the 1st of June, the 1st of July.
Okay.
The difference will be when it's installed, there will be slightly different messages to the installer about the smart regulations. When you start your charge, you may get a message to say there is a delay, random delay. We've not talked about that, have we? Before your car starts charging, and that opportunity to override it. That's fundamentally it. Everything else is hidden away inside the device and the firmware we put in it.
Okay. I mean, it's so you mean when you say tampering, that's mainly the software level that are worried about the tampering?
As we understand it, yeah. So the charge point has to have a tamper-proof boundary. So you've got a case that you've got to physically get into,
okay,
in order to get at the device and, you know, try and locally plug into it to tamper with it. So how can you cyber attack? You can come down the internet cable.
Yeah.
So you've got all the security and on that side of it. Or you physically get into the charge point and try and reprogram it or tamper with it inside. So,
yeah. All right. So you're in. So we've been saying, if someone takes the cover off your charger when it's powered up, they're going to get a message to say somebody's opened the cover.
Yes.
Right. And then you watch outside for a little transit van with someone in the back with a laptop.
Yeah.
And they're attempting to hijack the power grid from your charger.
That is part of the sort of the theory. Yes.
Right. So I mean, that's, you know, as soon as people. You know, we see loads of charge points coming to market from all sorts of places, and that sounds like a big risk for business to take on, isn't it? If you get it wrong, you could be responsible for a big.
And on one side, I mean, the attack on an individual charge point and the impact of that is going to be quite small. So we're looking, I think the government are looking at, if there's a cyber attack, could it do damage to UK infrastructure? So could we get every charge point in the country all turning on at the same time and blacking out the grid? Mm. And that's not, it's unlikely to happen from the guy in the transit van hacking the one outside your house.
Yeah.
But if they could get onto one charge point and then send a message to the next one and the next one and the next one, so that they then, that virus spreads, then that could be a problem.
Yeah.
From an industry point of view, we've got to take this seriously. We already do take security very seriously, so the risk is low. Mm-hmm. And the government are now making sure that everybody takes it just as seriously.
Yeah. Now, I mean, you mentioned that, obviously, that random delay as well. That's another part that features in this. It's got to be coded into the charger, a random delay.
Yes.
Why do we need a random delay?
Well, I mean, that goes back to this idea of everybody plugging in at the same time. So part of the regulation to try and shift the load to the off-peak at times. So that's the off-peak charging periods preferred. Everybody gets home from work roughly at the same time, and we all plug in together. The surge in demand on the grid could be too much for the grid to deal with. So what the regulations say is introduce a random delay of up to 10 minutes when you first plug in to try and spread that load. Now, when you come home from work, there's a bit of randomness there anyway, so that's probably not too extreme. But if we've all signed up for a low rate tariff and those tariffs all come in at 12:30, mm, then that's a lot of load to come on at the same time. And that's where the random delay will have more of a bigger effect in protecting the grid.
Mm.
Okay, so that's part of it. There is a side effect, though, which we need to understand as an industry and the government need to understand as well, is that if I've got a low rate tariff, which runs from 12:30 to 4:30, I want to make the most of that 4-hour period. Now, if I've got a 10-minute delay that's pushing me in, I've lost 10 minutes of cheap electricity.
Yeah.
Well, okay, that's boo-hoo. That's not a huge amount, is it?
Yeah.
But if I do that every night for the year, that's quite a lot of electricity that I've had to pay for at a higher rate than I'd like to.
Yeah.
So there is a subtlety around the regulations that still needs to be worked through at that point.
So at the minute, is the random delay fixed in the charge point?
Yes.
So if I've got a 5-minute, I've always got a 5-minute.
No, it's random on every event.
Right, okay.
So you could plug in now and it might be immediate, 1-second delay.
Yeah.
You plug in tomorrow, it might be 10 minutes. Next day, it could be 6. You know, it's all over the place.
Oh, okay.
But collectively, it will. And we have customers who I know contact us, and I speak to them, who say, well, you know, I had a charge period set from 12:30 to 4:30, and my Zappi didn't start charging until this time, and I've lost, and people are really very conscious of the cost of energy and trying to charge at the cheapest possible time. So I can see some challenges around that part of the regulations.
Yeah, I'm with them, Chris. We're in Yorkshire. I mean, we're always a little bit careful with the money. Economy 7, and I want, as soon as that time clock clicks over,
oh yes,
I'm in. But you can see, obviously, the problems it causes at a grid level if you've got, yeah, literally what could be
millions
of cars.
You've never invited me for a drink, you know. So talking about watching the pennies.
Yeah, we're here, Chris. We're not buying. But, yeah, I mean, yeah, you can see the sense in that document. It's obviously a major challenge for obviously manufacturers adopting this. Is there anything yet to come? You know, we started with what we called smart chargers, and we got a nice app and connected to the internet. Now we've taken that another stage further. We've got all this demand side response. We've got periods you can't charge. Is there anything? Is this the end of the road for the smart charger, or are we expecting other things to come in the future?
No, there's more to come. So this is the phase one of the smart charge point regulations. So phase two is planned to come. Government are beginning to consult on that. So we'll see more broad in. I think the direction of travel will be around interoperability between chargers, and also be able to, the fact is you as a consumer can move from one maybe demand response provider to another in the future.
Okay.
But it's early days for those regulations. They're coming in with these now, which is keep the lights on.
Yeah.
And then there will be more developments as the industry develops, or the market develops as
okay.
well.
Okay. So in the future, I'll have obviously my charge point. That's the great app that you've got that lets you track things. But then it's obviously then somebody else providing the demand side response management that may or may not be my energy provider as well.
Yes.
Okay, so that's, I mean, this is going to be, this is a massive step shift for...
It's very complex where it's going. And what we've got to make sure is that as whatever we do, government, industry, we have to make sure this is understandable and easy to follow and easy to use for consumers. Because I've got an electric vehicle, I want to plug it in, I want to be able to drive it when the next day when I need it, and I want to pay the right amount for the energy. And I'd like that to be as green as possible. So that's me as a consumer, it's quite simple, my needs. And in the background, there's all this complex stuff going on with computers and schedules and algorithms and security and,
No, it's a fascinating world. We're going to follow it with keen interest. You know, we came to Myenergi first when all this pen fault protection came out, and you helped us out with that enormously. You've certainly helped us today with this new regulation coming in. And follow it with close base. I'm sure we'll have some more content on it soon. So, Chris, thank you very much.
Okay, it's been a pleasure. Thank you.